Thank you for tuning in to Hope TV, the television broadcast ministry of Hope Alive Freedom Church. We are real people offering real hope in a real world.
Here we go.
At our church, Jesus is Lord. That single belief calls us together as a community and sends us into our world with hope and purpose. At our church, your past will never define your future. There's always redemption, which means there's always a brighter day. At our church, we don't think we're better than any other church out there. We're just doing our best to become our best. At our church, we want you to believe in God, but we also want you to know that God believes in you. We are not against people who don't attend church anywhere. Instead, we pursue them with love, the very same love that's pursuing us. At our church, we're learning to serve God with all our hearts, and we're learning to worship Him with all our lives. And if you're looking for the perfect church, we're not it. At our church, we will make mistakes, but we will choose to grow from them. At our church, we're part of a global community that's knit together by the resurrection of Jesus. And by the way, at our church, we believe that really happened too. At our church, we will engage with people who are in real need because we are the hands and the feet of Christ. And finally, we need you to hear this loud and clear. At our church, it's not really our church at all. It's His, and we live and move and breathe in His church for His glory and His fame, not ours. So here's the invitation. You're invited to jump in with your whole heart at your own pace and to experience the life that awaits you in Christ. Friends, this is going to be good. Welcome to our church.
Well, how are you doing this morning? How are we doing this morning? Everybody good this morning? Come on now. Can we give God a shout of praise this morning? How are you doing? Praise God. Well, it's so good to see you this morning. For those who don't know me, my name is Daryl Jackson Jr. I serve here at Hope Alive with my Sarah. with my wife, Sarah Jackson, as associate pastors. Now, before I go any further, do we have anybody worshiping with us for the first time this morning? Can I just see your hand this morning? We won't embarrass you. I just want to see your hand. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. I'm excited. We are excited that you are here this morning. I want you to know this morning that we have no hidden agenda. Our only aim for you is that when you leave this house, you leave with what, church? A little more faith, a little more hope, and a little more love than what you came in with. Church, can we give our special guest this morning a Hope Alive welcome this morning? Praise God. Now, maybe you say this is not your first time here. You've been checking us out. You've been seeing what it smells like in the house, what's going on. And you say, you know what? I want to be a part of what you're doing in the kingdom of God. I want to be a part of this house. Right in front of you, in the chair right in front of you, there's a Connect and Grow card. I want you to grab that card this morning. You can grab it right now. I want you to fill it out, and I want you to hold on to it. Because when we get to our offering towards the end of the service, Pastor Bobby will let you know what to do with that. Amen? Come on. Somebody say amen this morning.
Well, good morning, everybody. For those of you who do not know me, my name is Pastor Shannon, and usually I introduce myself and I say I'm Pastor Bobby's wife, but he always says, why don't you say I'm your husband? So Pastor Bobby is my husband, and in case we didn't get to introduce ourselves personally to you, we do once a month what's called the Growth Track Pastor's Breakfast. And I know for like a church our size, it's hard to be able to speak with every new person one-on-one. So once a month, next Saturday, 9 o'clock, Pastor Bobby and I want to invite those of you who have been checking us out or if it's your first time here. And what we do is we feed you boudin cracklings for breakfast. You know, I thought that was like a Richard thing. But I went to a few places where we bought boudin on a Saturday and it was packed. So I'm like, well, maybe it isn't just a Richard thing. So we're going to serve you boudin and cracklings and some donuts. It's going to be great. But what happens is you get to meet Pastor Bobby and I on a personal level. And we end up sharing with you our life story and telling you why we do what we do. So we would really, really love it if you come. And what happens is at that breakfast is a kickoff for something called the Growth Track. And what happens is there's a series of classes, like four of them, after that breakfast. And not in the same day, consecutive weeks. And what happens is you learn the culture of our church, how we function, what we believe. You also learn, you can become a, it's how you become a member. And then also, what is your spiritual gifting? What is your personality and how you can serve? So I really, really love it. And we want you guys to know you are so welcome to come next Saturday morning at 9 o'clock. Amen.
Go ahead and open up your Bibles or your Bible apps, whichever one it is, and we're going to make our declaration of faith this morning. Why don't you go ahead and thrust that Bible up into the heavens as our sword, our weapon of choice, our spiritual weapon of choice, and we're going to say this confession of faith in unison. Everybody together, say it with me with authority. Say it, this is my Bible. There are many like it, but this one is mine. It is God's holy arsenal, and with it, I shall make war against the enemy. I'm about to be taught the infallible, incorruptible, indestructible, ever-living word of the ever-living God. My heart is open, my mind is alert, and my spirit is eager to receive. I will never be the same. I'm ready, I'm ready, I'm ready. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Give somebody a high five before you sit down. If you'll turn with me to 2 Peter chapter 2, you might just put your finger there and mark that spot, and then we'll read a second passage of Scripture out of 1 Timothy chapter 4. So just go there and find that. While you're looking for it, I want to tell you a little personal story this morning. A few years back, my wife and I, we were taking a walk down the street. One of my favorite things to do of all times, and all my daughters will say yay and amen to this, one of my favorite things to do with my family is to go on a family walk. And what I really love to do when I go on a family walk, especially with my little girls, is I love to hold hands. Now they're getting bigger. They don't like to hold hands with dad so much anymore. But one day, all of my children are going to produce me some grandbabies, and I'll take them on a walk. They'll hold my hand. But my wife and I, we went on a family walk, and while we were walking down the street, we saw this $100 bill just right off the sidewalk in the grass, and it looked crisp, it looked clean. And, you know, my first thought was, let me look around, and, you know, somebody dropped this, you know. But it was so early in the morning, there was nobody around. So I picked it up, and my second thought was simply, wow, God is blessing me. I mean, money is falling from the heavens like manna in the Old Testament. I mean, it's raining blessings. I was looking around thinking, where's the money tree? Anybody with me? That was my first thought. Then I held it in my hands, and I showed my wife, and when I did that, I noticed some ink was on my fingers, and I just thought, well, you know, really, the print just didn't look right. And so then at that moment, I knew this was fake money. This was counterfeit money. Let me tell you what happened. At that moment, my wife and I became so disgusted with money. When the bank opened that morning, we immediately went to the bank. We took all of the money out of all of our accounts. We went back home. We grabbed a little fire pit that we have in the backyard. We threw all of the money in the fire pit and we set it on fire. We were just disgusted with money. We said, that's it. We're finished with money. And if you believe that, I've got a bridge to sell you to Hawaii. Of course, it's a story. My point is, how many times have you heard someone say that about Christians? How many times have you heard people say, well, Christians, they're all fake, they're all phony, they're all hypocrites. I don't believe any of this stuff. I'm done with anything that remotely resembles Christianity. I'm done with the church. I'm done with everything. Anybody ever heard anybody say something like that? I know I have. But see, the truth is, there can be no counterfeit without an original. See, the truth is, it is the counterfeit that proves the validity or the worthiness or the worthwhileness of the original. You won't see men counterfeiting Timex watch pieces. They counterfeit Rolex, right? Men don't counterfeit gum wrappers. They counterfeit $50 bills, $100 bills. Why? Because the $100 bill is really worth something. If it wasn't really worth anything, people wouldn't counterfeit it. Are you tracking with me today? So it is the counterfeit that proves the validity of what is real. Today, in a message entitled Authentic Christianity, the Character of the Counterfeit, I hope to introduce you to the original that you might be able to identify the counterfeit. Now, you have your Bibles. Let's read out of 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 1. Peter writes and says, Simon Peter, a servant of the apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who through the righteousness of our God and our Savior Jesus Christ have received a faith as precious as ours. That's the text. As a matter of fact, the King James translation says, Peter says, I'm writing this letter to those who have a like precious faith. It's similar. We're connected with the original. Now, if you will, 1 Timothy, the 4th chapter, Paul writes another letter, this time to his apprentice, verse 1. This is the ESV translation. And Paul writes, and he says, now the Spirit expressly says that in the latter times, some will depart from the faith by devoting themselves to deceitful spirits and teachings of demons. I believe in America, we are living in such a time. I believe in America, we are living under such a great delusion because of the dilution or the diluting of the gospel message. It is only the gospel, pure and unadulterated, that will create the authentic, the real Christian. Let me pray. Father, I pray today in the name of Jesus that you, at the releasing of truth, that you will bind every lie, every deception, and every spirit from which it comes from, that you would free those that are held captive today by false faith that produces a fatal end. Father, this I ask you, to the destroying of the yoke of religious bondage, to the destroying of the yoke of false religion, to the freeing of your people, in Jesus' name. And all God's people agree with that, said amen and amen. Well, listen, before I get into the message today, I want to say this. In order to spot a counterfeit, you don't invest your life into studying counterfeit pieces. I read an article this week. A guy had read a book that talked about, the way that the FBI agents identify or are trained to spot counterfeits is they go through an intense program where all they do is study the original. This guy said he had heard that before but didn't believe it, so he ended up getting an interview with the Canadian government and went in there, and this is what he found. He found that the way that the Canadians train their people to find counterfeit money is they truly do take the original piece of money and cause them to study that money. They use what's called a T to the fourth power method, which is, the first is touch the bill. Touch the original. What does it feel like? See, the original is made from a cotton woven blend of paper. So you can know and identify the original because the way it feels. See, the counterfeit will feel waxed. It's not real. So the first thing you do is touch. Then after you touch, then you tilt the bill. So you tilt it at different angles, and you got to look at it at different angles because the original has a holograph that will show all of the colors of a rainbow in the holograph on that bill. You can't reproduce that. Technology is not out there to reproduce that on cheap printers or even the best of printers that are out there. So you tilt that $20 bill, and then you look for the rainbow that appears. Do you follow me? So you got to look at this. Tilt this thing around so you can observe it from different angles, not just take it at face value. Then you'll take a look at it. So you touch it, you tilt it, you look at it, and you look at it, and when you look at it, you're looking at all of the fine printing on the bill. Sometimes if people are cutting paper, you'll see some of the white edge of the paper left on the dollar bill, very fine lines. But the original doesn't have it. You won't find that on the original bill. Then after you look at it, you pick up that $20 bill, and then you hold it up to the light. After you look at it, you look through it. Look for what's beyond there. In other words, you're holding the bill in the light, and all of a sudden the features of that bill will appear. And there's a small, in the Canadian $20 bill, there's a small ghost-like watermark image of the bill's main portrait, which is a picture of an English queen. So in order to spot the counterfeit, you don't go around studying all of the counterfeits. You must focus on the original. And I'm here to declare to you today that although I know there are counterfeit Christians, there can be no counterfeit without the original. But if you want to truly be able to identify the counterfeit, then you must know what the original looks like. And the way that you find that is, number one, we have this book, this sacred book called the Bible. That's the original. We don't have to go beyond the Word of God. We don't have to go beyond its literature. We don't have to go into the interpretation of preachers, modern day preachers of that literature. What's been bound is sacred. It is the original. Secondly, we can look to Jesus, who God sends as his only begotten son. The mark and the standard of the glory of God is Christ. Not even the best of ministers that you might know. Not even the best of Christians and church leaders that you might come in contact with. The standard is Christ. You follow me? The original. And then finally, we look at all the founding fathers of our Christian faith. So we look at all the New Testament patriarchs, like the Apostle Peter, who writes in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 1, who said, to those who have received a like precious faith. Now that like precious faith that Peter's talking about right there is talking about those like precious godly virtues. Peter identifies those virtues in chapter 1, and we're going to be speeding up to chapter 2 rather quickly. But in chapter 1, Peter identifies those virtues in verses 5 through 8 when he says, for every reason, make every effort to add to your faith authenticity. Add to your faith goodness and knowledge, self-control, perseverance, godliness, brotherly kindness, and love. These are the original virtues that stem from an original faith. Peter goes on to say in verse 8, for if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. In other words, if you and I continue to increase in these qualities, the church never dies. The faith never dies. Hope never dies. And the supernatural always continues to exist. So in chapter 1, Peter tells you about the original. And as believers, we should and ought to be always setting our focus upon the original. This is why Bible study is so important for you, not just on Sunday morning, but every day of your life. This is why, so that we would know what the original looks like. But in chapter 2, Peter goes on and then he begins to address. So in chapter 1, he addresses the original, but in chapter 2 of 2 Peter, he addresses the counterfeit. And in verse 1, this is what Peter says. But there will also be, in those last days, there will also be false prophets among the people. Not outside, but where? Among the people. Just as there will be false. Now that word false teachers, that word false translates to pseudo. In other words, fake, phony. There will be fake or phony teachers and prophets, people saying, God told me, among us. Are you tracking with me? Then Peter goes on to say, and they will secretly introduce destructive heresies and even denying the sovereign Lord. Mark that in your Bible. Highlight that Lord. Meaning this, Jesus cannot be your Savior until you're willing to make him your Lord. He is master of your life. Every aspect of my life is surrendered to the lordship and the authority of Christ. Jesus said, my words, they are life. Those that heed them live by them. So Peter says, and denying even the sovereign Lord who bought them with the saving purchase of his blood. Now here's the bad news. That's not even the bad news, right? The bad news, Peter calls this out in verse 2, when Peter says, many will follow these pseudo-Christians, these fake prophets, these phony preachers. And just because I have a pulpit don't mean I'm the only preacher in this house. Don't shout me down. Many will follow their shameful ways and will bring the way of the truth into disrepute, meaning shameful, they're going to shamefully smear the gospel. Verse 3, Peter continues and he says, and in their greed, these teachers, hear me out, these teachers will exploit you with stories they have made up. Then the Lord came to me in a dream. The Lord whispered to me the other day, if you've been with me any amount of time, you know that there are maybe a handful of times that I said, I believe the Lord spoke so strongly to me that it has totally governed my life in a thought, a God thought. It amazes me how freely Christians walk around saying, God said, God said, God said. It amazes me. Now, I know that we believe in a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, that God does speak to his people in a personal way. I think we all agree that it's part of our faith. Otherwise, it's a phony, fake religion. But this idea, I'm trying to get everybody centered here in this church. But this idea that people can so freely and nonchalantly walk around and say, I know God, and God spoke to me, God talks to me, and God said, and I'm like, bro, I don't say that. I know by faith I will heed the voices or the thoughts that God speaks. And another time, I'll talk about how God talks to you, right? And I'm going to make that personal. But that's not the message today. This message is a message of really severing every yoke and every tie of deception upon people's life. The gospel has been diluted by fake, phony preachers. And it's not just in pulpits. They're among you. The people that you might sit down with at coffee. But God says, you're going to know the original because they have a like precious faith. And there are certain qualities There are certain virtues that it, when you touch them, it doesn't feel waxed or plastic. You know what I'm talking about. When you come to church on Sunday, how you doing? Oh, I'm so blessed. And you can see right through that grin, there's nothing authentic about it. Oh, I got to fake it till I make it. You, all those things, they're waxed. They're plastic. So you got to touch them. Or maybe you got to look at them, not just at face value, but from different angles. Tilt them a little bit. Let me vet you a little bit. Not just somebody comes in and they're full of enthusiasm. And maybe they got a lot of charisma. And then before you know it, they're seducing people and dividing the churches, and churches are splitting. And I thank God that our church has withstood many attempts of the enemy to do that. Not one time, and may the blood of Jesus hold what I'm saying here very tightly, but not one time have we ever seen a church split in this church in a negative way. An argument, dissension, and people getting mad, and people leaving. You know why? Because I take my post very seriously to guard this flock. It's called the protective nature of a father, a dad. Not that I'm Father Bobby. You know what I'm talking about, right? Okay, all right, all right. That's my other friends. But sometimes you have to touch them. Sometimes you gotta tilt them a little bit. Sometimes you gotta look at the fine details. And sometimes you gotta look through them to see the motive behind what's being said. Listen to me, here's the deal. Verse 3 continues, says, in their greed, and this is about motive, in their greed, these teachers will exploit you with stories they made up. Let me tell you what I saw in a vision, bop, 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 and all of these things. And I'm not saying that God doesn't speak to people in dreams or visions or thoughts. I've preached this from this platform before, and I will continue. But what I am saying is we must know the original in order to counterfeit or to identify the counterfeit. As a matter of fact, the Bible says in the last days, the deception of the enemy would be so strong that even the elect would be deceived and God removed them. The very best of the best of us, the sharpest discerners of us all would be deceived. That's how strong the deception will be in the very last days. So Peter says, they're going to tell you vain stories. That word vain translates in the Greek to plastos. That's where we get the word plastics from. In other words, they're plastic stories produced by plastic counterfeit Christians. Here's my point. My point this morning is simply this. Don't discard your faith because of some fake counterfeit Christians that you've ran across. They're amongst us. They're where you work. They're where you go to the ballpark with your children. And they say that they're Christians, and yet, they're all over. See, the idea that people will say, do you know, Pastor, that there are some hypocrites in our church? It's just hilarious to me. I'm like, oh, well, please do tell. I'm totally unaware about that, Of course. I mean, even one of the disciples, Jesus' disciples, was a hypocrite. Right? There are hypocrites in every age and in every position. Some doctors are quacks, but you don't stop going to the doctors when you're sick. Some lawyers are shysters, but when you need legal advice, you find a good attorney. Some money is counterfeit, but you don't throw away the real money. You don't burn it in the backyard. The point I'm making is don't just turn away from the church because a few hypocrites. We don't do that. Let me tell you something today. Let me tell you something today, something for you to grab a hold to. I'd rather spend a few years in church with a few hypocrites than all of eternity with all of them. I'm just saying. Of course there are hypocrites, man. That's such a weak statement. That tells me how weak your faith is and how unauthentic your salvation has been. Of course there are hypocrites. This is what Peter is writing about. These pseudo-prophets, these plastic preachers and Christians, and all he's telling us to do is in chapter 1, you need to make sure that your election is real. You need to make sure your faith is real. You need to make sure that you are really saved. And then in chapter 2, he's saying, now you need to make sure how you recognize those who are not real, who are hypocrites, who are the counterfeit, lest they entice you and deceive you from that which is real. That's all Peter is saying. This is about the counter of the counterfeit in 2 Peter chapter 2. In other words, beyond the mask, beyond the message, and beyond the mask of ministry is the character of the Christian. And in chapter 2, Peter doesn't primarily deal with the counterfeit's wrong message, because you can have the right message, but that right message can be delivered from the wrong spirit. And if it's the right message from the wrong spirit, it's the wrong thing. All the same. Are you tracking with me? It's not about the wrong message. It deals with the 2 Peter is dealing with the, chapter 2 is dealing with the wrong motive. And character tells us not what they say, but character tells us what these guys are like. So Peter's not talking about false religion. He's not talking about people who are merely mistaken. He's not talking about people. What he's talking about is people who are willfully wicked, willfully, knowingly deceiving people. Those who have decided to cultivate, hear me out, a consumer Christian market in order to merchandise the gospel of Jesus Christ for their personal gain, for church growth. I'm going to make market of it so I can grow the church and make merchandise of the gospel. I've had done some real soul searching this week. And I told my wife, baby, I'm going to find myself. And our church is going to find itself. I'm not gonna dilute the gospel. And I'm not gonna forsake the calling. I'm not gonna live. I'm gonna find my center again. We have a great church. Great people. Wonderful people. Wonderful worship. I'm gonna talk about all that kind of stuff in part 2 of this message with solid doctrine. But my point is simply this. My heart at this time has genuine concern about an American church that promotes an American gospel. And the reason being is because preachers become performers and musicians become entertainers. How can I scratch the itch that's in your ear and tell you what you want to hear when what you need to hear and what you have to hear? These guys are pseudo. They're phony prophets that exploit you with made up stories to make a market out of you. Let me give you just a couple of marks of their character. We're not looking at the message, we're looking at the character. Let me give you 3 marks that Peter identifies here in chapter 2. He says, number 1, these guys are proudly presumptuous. They're filled with pride. They're arrogant. They're too sure of themselves. Number 2, their character is of beastly behavior. And number three, you'll know them by their godless greed. When I say proudly presumptuous, what I mean by that is Peter calls this out in verses 9 and 10. He says, then the Lord knows how to deliver the godly out of temptations and to reserve the unjust under punishment for the day of judgment. And especially, in other words, God is going to judge justly. But he says, especially those who walk according to the flesh, the lust of the uncleanness, of uncleanliness, and they despise authority. Watch this. Verse 10, they are presumptuous. The NIV Bible says they're bold, they're arrogant, they're self-willed. They're going to do what they want to do. They don't like the idea about authority. These guys will speak evil of dignitaries, especially. Chiefly, God's saying, I know how to judge justly, but my most severe judgment is going to be upon these religious phonies. When Jesus came, he had compassion on the thief, on the drunkard, and on the fallen. But he gave no slack to the religious frauds and fakers in his day. They're presumptuous. They're full of pride. And the root of all pride is the flesh, and that's what we see. They walk according to their flesh, meaning not, you know, the thing that we washed in the shower last night or this morning before we came to church. Not that. Talking about flesh. Talking about that predisposition to sin, that innate desire in all of us that crave sin. They walk according to that innate desire to sin. Flesh, in other words, their fleshly lives become filthy lives who walk according to the flesh and the lust of uncleanliness. So their pride produces this result, which is they despise authority. They don't want anybody to tell them what to do. Like a 6-year-old telling somebody else, you ain't the boss of me. They know nothing about spiritual authority or they're not afraid to talk about things that they know nothing about. As a matter of fact, verse 11, and this is the revelation of it, verse 11 talks about, whereas those who are even greater in power and might do not bring a reveling accusation against them before the Lord, but these, like brute beasts, talking about verse 10, they're not afraid to speak evil against anybody in authority. But these, like brute beasts, made to be caught and destroyed, speak evil of things they do not understand. And they will utterly be punished for their own corruption. What Peter's talking about here is he's talking about another scripture that we find in Jude, just a little epistle, Jude, in verse 9. The Bible says, Michael, the archangel, did not bring one accusation, one railing accusation against the devil. Listen, not because he wasn't scared of the devil. He just told him, the Lord rebuke you. Why? Because he knew that the devil was real. And this is Michael. Not that he's scared of the devil, but he won't rail against the devil, not because he's scared of him, but yet, listen, we live in a generation, stay with me, man. We live in a generation who don't take the devil seriously. God created him. Now, he's a fallen being, but God created him. Not that we're to give honor to the devil, but you need to take him seriously. But verse 11, the scripture says, angels won't do this, but these proud posers, they will. Spitting that stuff off. So you know them by their proud presumption. And number two, you'll know them by their beastly behavior. Verse 12 says this, but these, like brute beasts, in other words, creatures of instinct, made to be caught and destroyed, speak evil of the things they do not understand, and they will utterly perish on their own corruption. In other words, this is like spiritual suicide. You know, how many people live like animals today? Let's think about our culture. Let's think about the American culture. I might just point to some of our family. Oh, I'm getting serious. Let's think about I'm making jokes today because this is serious. Let's think about that. Let's think about how people live like animals. I mean, it's amazing how we can move heaven and earth to make monkeys out of ourselves. You know what I'm talking about? I'm talking about the whole theory of evolution. That whole idea that's been sown into our children's thinkings, into your thinking, a theory that you weren't created with divine purpose. It's not design, it's not divine design. It's a mistake. It's a cosmic mess. You're born from a monkey. You've evolved, and it's horrible. And so men begin to act like animals. And here's the deal. Listen, if it was unnatural, if it was counter to creation in the beginning of creation, it's still unnatural and it's still counter to creation today. But yet we act like animals. What do animals do? They live for self-gratification, self-propagation, and self-preservation. It's about them. So now there's no difference between man and beast. Men just begin to act like animals. And that's what these false pseudo-Christians are like. This is the character of a phony preacher, of a cheap Christian. Listen, man is not an animal. He's not just another part of the food chain. Man is a soul, God-breathed soul. And a man, listen, man without God is just like a dumb animal and he acts like a brute beast. Let me tell you where you see the climax of all of this in Scripture. The prophet and the beast, which is the Antichrist. The full manifestation about what I'm talking about that. The brute beasts who commit moral and spiritual suicide. And God's gravest judgment is reserved for these. And the Bible says in verse 13 and verse 14, and they will receive the wages of unrighteousness as those who count it pleasure to carouse in the daytime. They are spots, they are blemishes, carousing in their own deceptions while they feast, here's that word again, with you. In other words, the gospel is just a component that enriches a part of their life. It has not converted their life. So they sit and they mingle with you as a counterfeit right amongst us. Verse 14, having eyes full of adultery that cannot cease from sin, enticing unstable souls. Weak faith Christians. Guys that have no discernment because they haven't studied the original document called the Word of God. Let me bring this thing to a close this morning with that third characteristic of the pseudo-Christian, the false prophet, which is godless greed. Verse 14 says, they have trained their heart in covetous practices. They are accursed children. That word trained means just like an athlete goes to the gym to train themselves for whatever athletic event that they compete in, they train themselves to separate people from their money. I play psychological games with folk to separate you from your money. Verse 21 says, it would have been better for them that they would have not known the way of righteousness, having known it, to turn from the holy commandment and be delivered to them. Listen, they're willfully, knowingly, and deliberately deceiving folks. Phonies. They're deceivers who make merchandise of men. And then in verses 15 through 18, Peter goes on and gives an example about the prophet Balaam and the king Balak. That whole story. The same way. These are the ones who actually escape those who live in this era. In other words, there's a way to escape this. But if you're going to escape it, you got to focus on the original. And that means for your children, parents today, you must become the original. So, I conclude with this. So what do you do when you're surrounded by phony Christians and plastic preachers? This is what you must do. You must make your election sure. You must make sure that your faith is authentic faith, grounded in authentic gospel preaching. You must make sure that you know where you're going. Listen to me. Don't let some phony hypocrite keep you out of church and ultimately keep you out of heaven. I'm here to tell you today, trust and believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Cling to his word for all eternity. Amen? Amen. Amen. This morning, we have some people that are saying, I've made an authentic choice to be an authentic believer in Jesus Christ. Today, we're going to be baptizing people. As a matter of fact, I'm going to try this on for a while and see how it works for us. For every service that we do, at the end of closing, if people want to be baptized, I'm not making people wait 3 months to get baptized anymore. But there are 7 people today that have chosen to follow Jesus in obedience into the waters of baptism. Nobody has to go out there. You can stay right here because we're going to stream all of that up on the screen. We do have people out there taking photographs, so we'll catch the photograph. We'll get them to you all the same. Amen. So we're going to baptize 7 Christians today who say, "Yes, I believe in the original. For by grace am I saved, through faith, not by works or human effort of my own, but by grace I'm connected to an authentic gospel that connects me with the authentic people of God." How many guys are ready to see these guys get baptized this morning? Amen? Yes. Can you give me some happy music? Hey, listen to me. Before we take up the offering and we dismiss you this morning, I just want to bring this home to you. I have a feeling today that there are many people here that perhaps you have failed to examine your own faith, your own life, and the light of what's true. My question today is, if you were honest with yourself and if I was able to touch you and feel, if I was able to tilt you and look at you from different angles, if I was able to study your life in detail, hear me out, if I was able to study your life in detail, I mean, through the lens of the original, which is the gospel, the word of God, if I was to hold you up to the light and look through you, would your life be real? Or would your life show that your faith is a counterfeit? Here's the good news for you today. The good news today is you don't have to live a life of a lie. You don't have to be a fake, a hypocrite, a phony. I believe that genuine salvation is a miracle. And I'm going to talk about that next week in part 2 of this series, when we're going to identify the deceiver and all the different doctrines that take us away from fundamental stuff. But all I'm saying this morning is that salvation is miraculous. It's not a mental ascent. It's not pragmatism. It's not, okay, this is practical. Yes, this is the best choice for my life. You know, it will improve the quality of my life if I get involved in the church and I live for Jesus. But salvation don't come that way. Salvation is not emotionalism. The amount of, you know, goose pimples or goose bumps that show up on your arms. I mean, it's so much more than that. Salvation is a supernatural act. It's a supernatural act. It is a miraculous power that works inside the deepest part of every man's soul. When he comes to an awareness of truth, I am a sinner. I have fallen short of the standard. Jesus, the original, the Word of God, the standard. I've fallen short of glory. The Bible says all of us have fallen short of glory. But thanks be to God. Thanks be to God. He's made a way, right? He's made a way through His Son, Jesus Christ, that if we'll simply put our faith in Him, our hope in Him, and in true desperation say, God, save me, you and I can experience the miracle of salvation. He'll reach into your heart and He'll pull out that heart of flesh, that heart of stone, and He'll replace it with a heart of flesh, one that aches for Him, one that yearns for Him, one that wants to do right. Amen. Every head bowed, every eye closed, nobody looking around. You're here today or you're watching by television and you're saying, Pastor Bobby, when I examine my life in the light of truth, I know that my faith is fake. But today, I'm done with phony living. Today, I want to make a decision to not only ask Jesus to save me, but to make Him the Lord of my life. And that means I'm going to turn away from all of my sin, and I'm going to pick up my cross, and I'm going to follow Him. If that's you today, I want to pray with you. It's a simple prayer. It's one acknowledging your failure, putting your trust, believing that Jesus, the power of the cross, is still sufficient enough to save you and produce that miracle I talked about. And it is a prayer confessing Him as the Lord of your life. Would you pray with me right now? Say, dear Jesus, today I acknowledge all of my failures, all of my sin. I ask you to forgive me as I put my hope, my trust, my faith in you and in the wonderful work of Calvary. Today, I choose to turn away from my sin, to embrace you as the Lord of my life. So Jesus, here's my heart. I give you my life. Be the Lord of them both. In your precious name I pray. Amen, 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 amen. God bless you.
Amen, amen. Really quickly, if you do this, if you prayed that with Pastor Bobby this morning, and you really meant that, that was a heartfelt prayer, would you do something? Would you take 30 seconds? Grab that Grow and Connect card that's in the chair right in front of you. And would you fill that out this morning, then drop it off to one of the ushers on your way out? You know, we want to be able to connect with you. We want to be able to continue to pray for you because that decision is just the beginning of what God wants to do in your life. Likewise, if you're watching by television this morning and you prayed that prayer with Pastor Bobby, would you do this? Would you go to hopealive.com, scroll down to the bottom, and there's a button there that says Decision for Christ. Would you click that and fill that out? Likewise, we want to be able to connect with you and pray for you, even though you're not here with us in person to worship this morning. Amen. As the ushers make their way forward and you prepare your heart to give this morning, I want to share this with you out of the book of Romans, the 12th chapter and verse 9. It says this. It says, let love be genuine. Abhor what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. See, a genuine Christian hates what's evil. And you know what's evil, church? The love of money. When we begin to put our trust and our reliance, our dependence upon that money, that what we can make. But see, a genuine Christian places their full trust in Jesus, living a life of obedience. Because he can say, my God will supply all of my needs according to his riches and glory. It's not about what I can get, but it's about what I can give away. Church, this morning, I want to challenge you as you're obedient in your faith, as you give this morning, we are saying, Jesus, I'm placing my trust in you. I want to be a genuine, authentic Christian that doesn't love money, but loves Christ above everything else. Why don't you lift up your tithe this morning if you have it? I'm going to pray and dismiss that. Play and bless it, and then dismiss you guys this morning. Father, right now, I thank you for every Christian, every believer that is here. Father, we want to be the real deal. We want to be obedient in all that we do, especially with our money. We're making a statement today that money doesn't have a hold on us. Money doesn't have a hold on us, but we are living lives of full obedience to you, Jesus. We, right now, I bless every gift and every giver in this place, and it's in your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen, amen. Thank you so much for giving this morning. Really quick, I want to dismiss you guys, but before I do, two things. Number one, there are going to be prayer counselors up here at the front. If you have any personal prayer needs, I want to invite you to come find one of them. Let them pray with you before you walk out of here this morning. Sometimes you just need a friend, somebody to agree with you in prayer. And secondly, over here to your right, we're going to have a communion station. If you would like to receive communion this morning before you leave, Miss Charlotte and Anthony Jackson are going to be there to serve you. Go and grab some communion before you leave. Amen? You guys ready?
Yeah.
Awesome. Why don't you lift your hands up? I'm going to pray and bless you and dismiss you this morning. Father, right now I thank you that we are genuine, authentic disciples of Jesus here in this house. And as we leave here today, we are going to be the salt and the light of the earth. Father, everywhere that we go, let us be examples of you, authentic, genuine examples of Christians. Father, I pray your blessing and your protection over each person here. In your name I pray. Amen.
Pastor Bobby would love to have the opportunity to pray for you and your family. If you would like more information about the ministries of Hope Alive Freedom Church, check out our website at www.hopealive.com. And thanks again for tuning in.